still got this double hug shirt. One of the important things underlined by Vachanakaras, authors of poems, in English, for want of a better word, we call them Vachana poets, is that what they are writing is not intentional. But still, like other examples of a people, Vachanas have been the greatest treasure of Kannada poetry. So first of all, we have to puzzle out the foundation. On the one hand, they repeatedly say that we are not writing poetry. Poetry is a pack of lies. Poetry is concoction. We are writing poetry. So it began as a kind of anti-poetry. In Latin America, after Neruda and others, some poets like Nicanor Parra started writing anti-poetry. And in Europe, many people started writing anti-novel. So Vachana, in that sense, at the time, like most Bhakti literature, Bhakti expression, I would call it literature, Bhakti expression, was a kind of anti-poetry. What's happening here? We are trying to explain all literary expression in the light of Sanskrit poetics, Alankar Shastra, Dhvani Prasthana, etc. Dhvani, according to me, is one of the greatest concepts related by here. Critical imagination, no doubt about that. But I'm afraid Bhakti poets, including authors of Vachanas, never care for any kind of established poetics. Instead, they created their own poetics. G.L. Devi, he wrote his famous book after Amnesia, some 30-40 years ago. He became a kind of cult book of his. They were all very deep in his days. When he came back, it was not such a great revolution. He's argued that only in Sanskrit did they develop a kind of express kind of poetics, where the bhashas didn't do that. I've been engaged with ancient and medieval Kannada literature in the last several years. Now I find it completely wrong. Because all languages created their own poetics. For example, Kannada, Pampa, the first Jaina poet, who wrote the poetic biography of Adinathan Vidyantara, Adi Purana, he talks about two types of poetry. One is Laukika Agamika. He wrote two poems. One is based on Mahabharata, Jaina Mahabharata, not other Mahabharata, where Krishna is not a god, Krishna is a noble being. Karuna is the hero. And then Adinathar, the story of Adinathar, Adi Purana, which was a translation of a work written by a great Sanskrit poet at the court of Rupatunga the first, the Rashtrakuta emperor. This is called Purva Purana. Acharya Gunabhadra had written that. Pampa translated to this Gunabhadra Acharya's. And this set work, the Gunabhadra Acharya's work is magnificent, huge, but sum it up into a short, beautiful work. He says, the point is, he talks about two kinds of poetry, Laukika and Agamika. For him, Mahabharata is Laukika Karya, it's a mundane poetry. Whereas the story of Adinatha Tirthankara is spiritual, Agamika. Where are you going to the Laukika? Ali Agamika. So in Mahabharata, he says, I eliminate the mundane world, whereas in Adi Purana, I eliminate the divine world. So this distinction we don't find in Sanskrit.
Excuse me, this is Agamika.
Agamika. So this distinction we don't find in Sanskrit. This created by Kannada imagination. In fact, it owes something to Acharya Gunamudra himself and Pampa develops on this. So Pampa laid the foundations of ancient Kannada poetry, which is predominated by Jaina philosophy. And of course, Sheldon Pollack, who is a great literary historian of South Asia, he ascribes the evolution of a new literary culture in Karnataka and then the whole of South Asia to a work on poetry called Kaviraja Marga. I'm afraid that Sheldon Pollack is completely wrong, because this Kaviraja Marga is a translation of Dandi and Pama in Kannada. Nothing original about it. It has no impact on Kannada poet, because none of the Jain, this author of Kaviraja Marga was a Jain, none of the Jaina poets even mentioned his name. So the poetics in Kannada was created by George Spencer's, not by politicians. And after this phase of ancient poetry, this rich efflorescence of Jaina native poetry, it was then there was another great efflorescence in Kannada, the light of which is unprecedented anywhere to the best of my knowledge in the future. That is the explosion of Vachanavi. Normally, some three or four Vachanakaras are considered to be major ones. Ramanujan didn't translate to this text into English. He considered, gave credit of this to Devara Dasaneya, Dasaneya Deviva, Basavanna, Allama Prabhu. He made them the protagonists. This had its precedence when Vachanavi texts were compiled in the Vijayanagara period during the time of Prodadeva Raya, the first, the Salva king who ruled Vijayanagara before Vachanavi. Vachanavi expression came like a sudden efflorescence. Where it began, nobody knows. It's true that Vasavanna, Akramadi, were very important, but they did not really, even before Vasavanna and Akramadi. The first Vachanakara name is an untouchable poet, Channayada Kamba. He is called the father of Vachanas. To this day, upper caste, the guys are trying to fight Shayyamdas. They try to establish that Madhara Chinnaya came after Vasavanna. So they are happy with this Vachana who been started with Vasavanna and Rambi Pantai Nandishwara. But it's corroborated textually that Madhara Chinnaya is the first, it's called Adhya Vachanakara. And then comes Devana Dasimaya, Dasimaya the Viva. And then comes Dohara Kakkaya, Kakkaya the Shyana. Then comes Dashaguna the Singhi Deva. Singhi Deva, the street performer. And all of them belong to untouchable or semi-untouchable performers. There is a school of Marxist thought in India which thinks that all spirituality is bad. But unfortunately, the reverse is true. All spirituality is not practical. It's the creation. All schools of spirituality are a creation. Achievement of the artisan classes. So all these people came from the artisan caste. To be more precise, left-hand caste. Today, this distinction between the left-hand and right-hand caste obtains only among untouchable communities in some parts of India. For example, in Karnataka, the Mehas, the Odiyas are called right-hand caste. And the cobblers are called left-hand caste. Sometimes very confusing. There was an anniversary of the Dalit organization in Kannada, and people were discussing that they should go to the left parties or right parties. And one of the left discrepancies, oh, you're still discussing left-hand, right-hand. So it's sometimes busy. Anyway, in Medieval India, all the castes which had direct contact with the means of labor, artisans, they were called left hand. European sociological Bernstein and work of this, all these castes were called left hand. So, Vachana, poets, poetry, the pioneers of Vachana, writing, composition, the left hand artisans. Now today, people who make Basavanna the hero of the Vachana movement, I award you to the movement business. It was not the kind of movement like freedom movement or some other movement. So it creates a certain kind of movement in society, but it's not a movement in that sense. Anyway, call it a goddess in some other tradition, whatever, not movement. So, it had no one origin, must have been. And there was a kind of new spirituality that is emerging out of the direct spiritual experiences of the artisan poet saints. And they didn't go to a temple to have spiritual experience. They didn't go to the Himalayas to have spiritual experience. They didn't read the Vedas to have spiritual experience. They didn't quote Shastras to have spiritual experience. They had spiritual experience through the practice of their own labor with others. For example, to illustrate this, I can quote a poem by Ramanna the Cowherd, Guru Gadi Ramanna. His job was to herd the cattle. He says, Udayadalli Brahmana Kali. At dawn, I heard Brahma. Madhyanadalli Vishnu Kali. At noon, I heard Vishnu. Astamanadalli Rudrana Kali. At twilight, I heard Rudra. Kattadiradamele Govugada Hattige Hoidu. After darkness had set, I sent all the my cattle back into the fold and I asked Gopatinatha Vishveshwara, for him Shiva, he also a cowherd, Gopatinatha Vishveshwara, when will I be rid of this cowherd stick in my hand? Not till the time when Gopatinatha Vishveshwara is in service. So he's expressing this perform a great experience through just the description in the idea. And if you look at Madharachanaya, for example, he describes the spiritual process by comparing it with different stages of making sacrifices. How the hide is tanned, and how it is put in a caustic water, and how the leather is purified, and how it is hit with the So, labor for them is the window, the door for spirituality. So, this emphasis on direct personal experience, of course it was there in the Upanishads, Pratyaksha is said, but time and again it was forgotten. Well, symbols become more important than what is symbolized. The human beings are alienated from individual experience. Thus, poetics replaces poetry. In the beginning of space, this theory has replaced poetry. So, you shroud yourself with words, and don't see the truth, immediate truth, which is personal. So, after this, Basavanna appeared in the scene. About his life, you know, there is a lot of mythology is there, but there is history. He was born in a place in Jagunichi, etc., and so on. He became the accountant general of the Emperor Mithila, who was ruling him, not from Kalyana, but from Mangalavedi, this part of Mangalavada, spoke to Sholapur. he usurped the throne from Chalukya, Dailapa the third. But according to one of our most brilliant historians, he never went to Kalyana. He ruled from Kalyana. So mythology says that he went to Kalyana. Kalyana became the center of this Vajna inflorescence, and that's where this fight happened between upper caste and lower caste. A Brahmin girl was married to an untouchable boy, which led to violence, not to violence. Historically, the emperor was assassinated. Why was it? We don't know. Maybe he was assassinated for political reasons, etc. etc. There was violence and so on. But whether it has what directly to do with anything with the this coercing this. So we don't know. So as I said, there's a lot of mythology, there is history, but the only documents we have on the proclamation of Bharat and the Vaishnavas and this is a huge body of the Department of Culture of published some 20 volumes of this, written by nearly 280 poets. Some of them probably voluminous, out of which some 40 are written and some 50 to 20 of the untouchable communities, untouchable women, to speak of high philosophy. Every walk of life, name any profession, barber, cobbler, town crier, tailor, doctor, farmer, washerman, you find the representation of every community of those days would be the older. Ramanujan makes vague generalizations. They're like the revelation of Jewish Christianity, like the Gospel of Christians, like the Upanishads, like this, that. It's very vague. But we should listen to Vajnas themselves to understand how they consider the world. Sheldon Pollock makes a very important point. Trying to understand ancient texts, listen to the text for your theories about them. So we should listen to what Vaishnava themselves perceive to be. I'll just give you a few examples. On the basis of this, I've been trying to construct what is called the poetics of Vaishnavas. It's not just Sanskrit poetics, poetics of Vaishnavas, because there's a lot of inbuilt poetics. Even Bhakti and other texts, for example, in Assam, Acharya Shankaradeva, he created a new kind of art, new kind of music, and he built his theories into his, you know, into his creativeness. Similarly, in Vachanas, we had a lot of inbuilt poetry. So, Papa distinguished between Laukika and Dharamika Kavya. He tried to work on poetry, but he built this into his, the body of his. Now, in this tradition, they do not believe in any scripture. And right now in Karnataka, there's a big political movement that is shaping up. Ligas are declaring that this is not in Christians. As about this moment, because we don't believe in the Vedas, we don't believe in the Quran, we don't believe in all this temple worship and so on. Practice, of course, most of these people go there. That's a different thing. But in theory, it's completely misunderstanding. It's not part of it. If you try to understand bhakti movements as a reformatory phase, Protestant Hindu movements, we are completely distorting the reality of the independent. And they were not. And some, Marxists say they were protest movements. Even this is wrong. There were new examples of cultural creativity in themselves. They're not independent. They're not the shadows of Brahminism or whichever ism, something else. And some people think it was a feminist revolution. No. And some people think it was a failed Marxist revolution. If only they had read Karl Marx, they would have done better. If only they had read the feminist, they would have done better. So all kinds of speculations float around. But let's see what they think about the conclusions. Basavanna says, Buddhidare Muktina Harada. You're conscious of the word. So you speak. Should you speak, your word should be like a string in the words. Buddhidare Muktina Harada. Buddhidare Spatikara Shalakayantiravi. If you speak, the word should be crystal clear and little sharp. Spatikara Shalakayantiravi. Buddhidare Linga Mechi Ahuru. You should speak so beautifully that even God, Linga, should say, yes, yes, you're right. He says, Buddhidare Linga. Unless your words match your actions. So one of the chief emphasis in Vajrayana philosophy, poetic philosophy, is the interdependent relationship between moody speech and nade. Nade is walking. Walking also refers to what nade? To actions. There's another more esoteric point by Alamuru. He says, Yerado Kantrulavara Gandharva Nenbaru. When you see somebody in two eyes, they call him a Gandharva. Muru Kantrulavara Maheshwara Nenbaru. Somebody has three eyes, they call him Maheshwara. Mayilla Kantrulavara Sadashiva Nenbaru. Somebody has eyes all over his body, I call him Sadashiva. Adhane Bokeshwara, Lord Bokeshwara. Ramana translates the Lord of Jesus completely wrong. Text Bokeshwara, not Bokeshwara. So, Bokeshwara, Nitma Sharana Allamange, Angalalli Kandribandhar. Your devotees have the eyes in their toes. Then I call them Anupama, Mahima, Anupama. I call such a person, like me, the incomparable paragon of virtues. So, if you want to become incomparable paragon of virtues, your eyes the organ of seeing, understand? And your toes are the organs of walking. They should come together. So this emphasis on Mugi and Nadi, word and action, is constant in Vajrayana philosophy. It is said that Vajrayanas are against, Brahmins, against Jainas, against the Vaishnavas. Partly true, but not always true. Because what they're attacking among Brahmins, among Vaishnavas, Shaivas, Jainas, Tantrics, Yogis, the practitioners of all schools of spirituality, and the followers of tribal religions, village religions, worship all kinds of objects. Vasmana says, Mora Daiva, Malake Daiva, how many gods? The winning board is a god, and the pot is a god, stone is a god, the tree is a god, the snake house is a god, the vessel is a god. Daiva, daiva, vendu, kaviyali yukhila. There's no place on this earth for human beings to walk on, because it's filled with everything is one. Ye guru madakege, gurasandama deva, sharanandu. I'm going to smash all these thousands of pots with one word, Buddhism. So, the point is, all these people are practicing something that is different from what they taught. For example, first one I have told you. Kalla Nagara Kandar Haladayam Paraya. You know, the snake worship is very common in the hills of India, ancient practice. So when they look at a stone snake, they say, go and offer a limb to the snake god. Jadama agar akar kare, Adiyam Shariya. When the real snake comes in, Uruva Jangama Vandaran Adiyam Baro, when a holy mendicant comes and asks her on, they say, get lost. Unnala Vikas Kevodam. They offer so much of rice to stone lingam who doesn't eat. But this is hypocrisy. They are not only against Brahmins, Jainas, Pandits, but also against Shaivas and Tamilas who worship the Shiva lingam. One poet, Ambigara Chodaya, the both ones, there is one of the Vachanas. Kattidalingavavittu, Vettadalingakke hodi, Pattayadiyagi namisuvana kandade, Dinna, Yadapadala, Mettadale, Adanno Amedjadalli Antti, Avana Muttumukakke, You see a person who wears a Shivalinga, abandons it, and goes to the top of the mountain to worship the Lingam. You look at it, take out your lips, dip it in shit, and hit on his face 78 times, says Chaudhary. So they oppose this first power of Lingam. Vasudeva, this famous poem about Ullavaru Shivalaya, the rich build the temple for Shiva. Anena Madeva, what can I go and do with the Lord? And Yenna Kale Kamma, my legs are the pillars, Dehave Devala, what is the temple? Shirave Vamma Kanasaraya, my head is the pillar. Whatever is moving. So the traditional belief is people build monuments, they immortalize themselves. But there's always, like in Chile's poem, Ozyman Diaz, he says, I'm the king of kings, look at me, but this statue shattered, it's in the desert, and nobody is there. So all these monuments give way, but what is lives on is the dynamic living human body. So that's where it is, the temple. And the temple, for instance, was originally the copy of the human body. Then the temple becomes more important than the human body. Look at the parts of the temple. Kalasha is the head. Different parts of the temple become different parts of the body. Symbol becomes more than what is symbolized. Therefore, they reject. So it was against all schools of scripture which practiced the opposite of this. Another very amusing point of this. Kavadigano Bhupadati, a snake charmer, and his broken nosed wife, they are going to find a match for this song. The snake charmer has a snake in his hand. His wife is broken. And it's normally believed that to see a snake charmer in the skin of person is a bad omen. Then from the other direction, another snake charmer with a snake in hand, with his wife, is also broken. He's coming to look for a match for his son. So this snake charmer yet says, oh, bad omen, let's go back. Forgetting that, he sits on the snake charmer. So what do you call this? Shaitan. So the satire in the Vachanas is it hits out that this lack of coordination between words and speech and action. So this emphasis is the essence of Vachanapurti. Then we come to the Nitya Vachana. Vachana, before Kannada Vachanas came, the word Vachana was used in the context of Champoka Vyas. Shampoos cover yourself, switching passages, Devya, and closed passages, Devya, Devya, closed passages, Devya, Vachana. But it's not in the sense that the word Vachana is used in Bhakti literature. Vachana is a new genre of poetry created by our Bhakti traditions. We have equivalents of Vachana in different languages. For example, Kashmir, we have Lalla Wak. In the Gorakhpath, you have Vani, Gorakavani. And Kabir Path, you have Kabir Vachana. And in Marathi, you have the equivalent of this Ovi. So, it's a new kind of composition that the people has created as a new way of expression. Not only spiritual, but also it's not only spiritual. This poem of the snake charm and his wife is a piece of excellent social satire. It's not only spiritual. So, it's not always that Vachana poets talk to God. Sometimes they refuse to talk to God. It's more important to earn one's daily bread than to do puja path. A long process of devotions. Na deva na lulare ni deva. If I have not God, how can you be God? Hasidaga ok kulita nigani suchiyadaga hasidaga tuktu anna vani kure. When I'm hungry, I eat a mustard of rice. When I'm thirsty, I drink a glass of water. Mahadeva Kana Vishwara. I am not you. Videva Nada Yanadeva Kaya. If you have got, why am I taking care of? Why should I eat? Why should I go looking for water? What can I have got? Sometimes they even talk to me. Vachana, there are two kinds of expression. Some of them traditionally explained into Sarada Vachana, simple Vachanas, and then Bedagina Vachanas. Ramanujan called it inverted speech, but they are little like Vachanas. Basavarna, for example, writes mostly Sarada Vachanas, which is straightforward Vachanas, which are metaphorical, while Allama Guru writes more symbolic, and the kind of expressions which are similar to what is called Sandha Vasha expression in the past. It's kind of twilight language, the spiritual language in the Kabir Path is called Ultiya Vasa Sandhi. Kabir Munaki says, everybody says that the sky, the rain descends from the sky, and the earth is bringing crops. But there are times when the earth rains, the sky is bringing crops. So it inverts every day. So one of his Bedagina Vachanas, he says, Ganga Devi Mundi Yadav. Ganga, she was Pati Pati Go. She became the world. Gauri Devi Vodaya Prati. And Gauri removed her earrings. So, you know, part of the world, the husband dies when they remove their earrings. Vasudeva Vimana Vajattu. Vayudeva Vimana Vajattu. The wind god carried the fire. Vasudeva Kuliyari Kidan. Vasudeva, Krishna, lit up the fire. Akhtilatta Vokeshwara Sattani Vasudeva. From then on, the newspaper, Vokeshwara, dead. So, the deity, sometimes Akhtamavu Sattani, begin Vajna tradition. The deity is mostly not always considered the Shiva Linga, held and worshipped as a god. Even ultimately, that symbol has to be transcended. Allah Guru says, Puruhu Paratallaga Aruhu Satyavagaru. Unless the symbol dies, you cannot have a presence. The symbol has to die. The true symbol, we have to transcend the symbol. Sinayadittu. Sinayadakida. Sinayadora. So, simple is a kind of limitation. So, you impose this limitation on yourself only to transcend this limitation when you become everything. The ultimate goal in the Dhamma Prasada, he calls it Nishunyani. Nagarjuna talks about Shunya. But Vachana poet philosophers talk about non-Shunya, Nishunya. So the conceptually they're going further beyond Shunya, Nishunya. He said, Shunyanalli Nishunyavagittu, Vayanalli Nirvayanagittu. It became Nishunya and Shunya. In openness, it became non-openness. Vayanalli? Vayanalli Nirvayanagittu. So, you want transcending your experience, going beyond and beyond and beyond. This is the journey that we find in Vachana expressions. And there are different parts to it. Devotion could be one part. And labor is a very important means, because it began with the laboring classes, artisans. For example, there's a story about Vachana poet Kanduliya Chandaya, Chandaya the poet. Like all the Sharanas, those who are surrounded with Vachana poet, those who are Sharanas. Now there's also debate in the market. But I agree to neither of them. They're called Sharanas, they're called Guru Sharanas, or Sharanagmanas. So he's wearing the kind of Shivalingam, and he goes to cut some plants to make rope, and the Shivalingam falls down. He gets angry. He says, "Take my sister." The Shivalingam says, please take me back, take me back. He says, "No, I shouldn't wear it." What do you find out? You're distracting from the process. And the Shivalingam follows him. He says, if you want me to take you back, you go and do some honest labor and come back, earn some money, come back. Then I go. Then Shivalingam goes and complains to Basavana. Basavana says, please, Shivalingam goes to Shivalingam. There is nothing to be wishing about, for me, labor is sacred. Ultimately, Shivalingam apologizes to Chandraya. This is a legend which is included in the 15th century anthology of Vachanas by Shunya Sampada. Virya. And then there's another Vachana by Dureya the Kompla. He is making sandals. And from the point of the Godkin, ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರತ್ಯಕ್ಷನಾದ ಪರಮೇಶ್ವರನ ಕಂಡೆ ಶಿವ ಕನಿಂಗ್ ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವರ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ವಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಸ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಇತ್ತೇಕೆ ಬಂದ್ರೆ ನಿನ್ನ ಭಕ್ತರಿ ಪಟಾವಂದಿಗೆ ಹೋಗು ಗೋ ಟು ದ ಹಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಯೋರ್ ಡೆವೋಟೀಸ್ ನಿನ್ನ ಬೆಳ್ಳಿಯ ಬೆಟ್ಟಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗು ಗೋ ಟು ಯೋರ್ ಸಿಲ್ವರ್ ಮೌಂಟೇನ್ ನನಗೆ ಕಾಮ ಹೂ ಹುಲೇಶ್ವರೀಸ್ ಅಂಕಿತ ಸಿಗ್ನೇಚರ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾಮ ಹೂ ಹುಲೇಶ್ವರ ಲಾಟ್ ಲಾಟ್ ಲಸ್ಟ್ ಲಸ್ಟ್ ಟಸ್ಟ್ ಟಸ್ಟ್ ಕಾಮ ಹೂ ಹುಲೇಶ್ವರ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅಂಕಿತ ವಚನ ಕಂಪೇರ್ ಟು ಪ್ರೀ ವಚನ What is important about Vachana is that in Bhakti literature, they brought in the signature line. Kehat kavi rasulo vaisa Tukaram, Tukamani, Manishwar, Nanamani, and so on. Muktamani, says Tukaram. Vachana poets most often have the name of the Guru. Or the Ishtadevata, Ishtadevata, one of the versions of Shiva, as the signature line. And sometimes they are proper nouns. Akamadhi is Vachana. Channa Mallikarjuna. Mallikarjuna is one of the Jyotinikas. Chandna Mallika Arjuna. Chandna means draped like this, like jasmine. But this great translator Ramananda translates this Lord as much as jasmine. This goes against the culture, because in our language, white is never considered to be the mark of beauty. The names, people are named as Kappamma, Gapuman, Kappanna, Krishnappa, Kempanna, Red Brother, Kempamma, Red Woman, never Bidiyappa. Why it is not considered mark? And Channa, the word Channa comes from the Tamil Cham, Cham means red. And Ramanujan, for some reason, because it sounds very nice to white people, but if you think that this medieval Roman state was written by a white man, he translates this as God is what it has. So the Ankita itself is very simple. So what is the meaning of Akamadeva's Ankita, Chantam Ankita? So most of the Ankitas consist of what is called Arisamasa in Sanskrit. In Sanskrit, grammar prohibits the combination of a Dravidian word with a Sanskrit word. So Channa is a Dravidian word. Mallikarjuna is a Sanskrit word. Basavana Sangita, Kudala Sangamadeva, Kudala, Dravidian word. Sangamadeva in the Sanskrit. In Alama Prabhu Bhogeshwara, Ishwara, Uttara Padanta, second word is Sanskrit. Bhogga. Bhogga is a word taken from a tribal language. So, what is happening here? It shows a kind of the clash and reconciliation between different cultural strands. So, this clash is resolved through reconciliation, because they do not care for the rules of grammar, they care for expression. Channa Malli, Channa again says this in red, beautiful. Mallika, yes, very familiar. Arjuna, the Mahabharata, in Sanskrit, Arjati iti Arjuna. Arjuna is the one who conquers, earns. So it has the masculinity of Arjuna and the femininity of the jasmine. When they come together, Channa. So there are a lot of meaning built into these Ankitas, and there are poems in literature by. Now, when I was asked to give a title to my presentation, which was today, I said, talking straight with God, men, women. Vachana is their expression. The narrative traditions that preceded Vachanas within Sangam tradition in Tamil, a Prakrit tradition in the north, south, Sanskrit tradition is mostly katana related. What Bhaktin would call indirect speech. Bhaktin describes the Sri tradition as a kind of indirect speech. Somebody says something and then says it for school. For example, Toma wrote the Odyssey, and some episode Greek rewrites it and rewrite it, and somebody else rewrites it. First, Aeschylus rewrites the story of Oedipus. And then Sophocles rewrites it, and then Euripides rewrites it, and then many traditions rewrite it. So literary tradition progresses as a kind of indirect speech, is what Bhaktin says. But in India, we have this tradition of direct speech, Vachana, talking direct. So address is very important. For example, Veda Purisharara, Nimma Veda, Vedas Nadu Vedakke, Vedalla. You, people of the Vedas, what could your Veda understand? ಆಗಮ ಪುರುಷರಿರ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಆಗಮ ಸರಿಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಯು ಪೀಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಗಮಸ್ ಯೋರ್ ಆಗಮಸ್ ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಪುರುಷರಿರ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಸಾಧಿಸಲೇ ಕೆಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲ ಯು ಪೀಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ನೆವರ್ ಕುಡ್ ಸ್ಲೀಪ್ ಮದರ್ ಚಿನ್ನೆ ಶಿವ ಗುಡಿಯ ಮನೆಯ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರತ್ಯಕ್ಷವಾದ ಪರಮೇಶ್ವರನ ಕಂಡು ಕಿತ್ತಲೆಗೆ ಬಂದೆ ಅಯ್ಯ ಇವರು ಇಪ್ಪತ್ತೊಂದು ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಅಯ್ಯ ಫಾದರ್ ಸರ್ ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ರಾಂಗ್ addresses I dropped. So the addresses contain the power of vachanas. They're talking to somebody. Never talking to this. To sister, to my sister, Akka Kira Ovala, my sister, listen to him, experiences. For example, Stokpa's Adi Purana is a great work, but it's about other people's experience, not one's own experience. The Vachanapas are always talking about their own experiences, not anybody else's experiences. And therefore, the Vachana also becomes Vachana in the sense of promise. I'm making a promise that this is how I speak. Direct speech and also a promise made. So, the composition is full of such wide variety that I can't do justice to all the diverse strands, the diverse.